Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the very best in professional wrestling. That is Worldwide Wrestling. Tony, we saw right at the top of the program, new World Tag Team Champions, the Rock and Roll Express.
And they were on our program just last week, and what a program it was. We saw a new U.S. Heavyweight Champion, that is Nikita Koloff, winning the Best of Seven Series over Magnum T.A. And we saw Baby Doll with Ric Flair down. Walking to the ring with Ric Flair and embracing Ric Flair.
I know, and what she did with Ric and how they went after Dusty. I still don't understand it.
But we do want to talk about, like you said at the top of the program, New World Tag Team Champions. The whole world glad that it's the Rock and Roll Express, the New World Tag Team Champions.
Tony, you wonder, you know, maybe the Midnight Express wouldn't have lost their championship if someone had been paying more attention to them instead of talking.
Instead of being a commentator.
That's right. Is that right, Mr. Cornette?
Let me tell you something, David Crockett. First of all, I heard that snide little comment. Do not try to tell me my business and don't try to tell me what to do. First of all, Dusty Rhodes, Big Bubba's got your number. You see him right here? And I don't care whether it's in a cage match or a Louisville street fight, maybe. He's going to take care of the big American dream. And then I'm going to go on to lead my Midnight Express back to victory, back over the Rock and Roll Express to get our tag team titles that we never should have lost in the first place, that were stolen away from us on a fluke win. And David Crockett, don't you try to tell me how to go about it, and don't you try to tell me how I could have prevented the loss. I'll tell you how I could have prevented the loss, because I could have prevented the loss by getting that referee out there, because he was crooked. They pulled my man's tights. He gave us a quick count. It was nothing but a fluke. At Rock and Roll, there will be another day, and I'll guarantee you one thing. When you lose those tag team belts, Rock and Roll, you're going to lose them to the greatest team in professional wrestling. I'm talking about my men, Loverboy Dennis and Beautiful Bobby, the Midnight Express.
Those World Tag Team titles, our World Tag Team titles, back from the Rock and Roll Express. We're going to destroy some people. We're going to annihilate some people. And right there, you see Bill Mokey, my man Bubba, already dead and buried Randy Mokey, Mokey Mania, and Bill Mokey out for revenge against us. But it ain't going to do any good. And Vernon Deaton, he is nothing but a pipsqueak. He's a piece of trash. He's lower than the slime that hangs off the sewer when you open it up. And he's going to be destroyed too, David Crockett, and everybody else that gets in the ring with the Midnight Express, the greatest combination of sports, the best team that there's ever been in professional wrestling. Everybody else is
Here
going to get destroyed
Bobby,
too. Beautiful
it.
Bobby, the greatest aerial artist in professional wrestling. And that's exactly why that the Rock and Roll Express were beaten up so bad after they won those belts that Robert Gibson couldn't even wrestle about
this.
5 or 6 days.
No protection.
That's right.
Face
a
first
face
right
buster,
in the mat.
And it's going to be all over if Dennis wants it to be over. And he does. We're going to annihilate some people to reach what we're after, the World Tag Team Championship. Our belts back from the Rock and Roll Express.
Look at it. They still have him there.
Intensity out of Loverboy Dennis, and that's what we're getting. That's nothing but a couple of pieces of garbage.
And we can put the rock and roll. Start the chat again. Rock and roll.
It ain't going to do him any good to chant Rock and Roll Express, because after we get finished, there is going to be no Rock and Roll Express. Get out of there, Vernon Deaton, you piece of trash. Look at that. My boys, poetry in motion. They are the greatest. They take no prisoners. They take no names. Is kick some you-know-what, so they're going to kick the Rock and Roll Expresses.
Well, they are not the World Tag Team Champions, but that is not lower their intensity at all. Let's take a look once again at Loverboy Dennis on Vernon Deaton. Face first, right down to the mat. The Midnight Express are the winners, and I think we want to talk more about new World Tag Team Champions. Here's Jim Cornette.
Well, now I think you people have seen that the Midnight Express, regardless of what anybody says, and don't believe a word from anybody but me, they're the greatest tag team that there's ever been. And I'll tell you something else that you can believe. Dusty Rhodes, American Dream, you had your shot, baby. You had your shot to apologize to me and apologize to Bubba. But what did you do? You chose to attack the man, the baddest man in the world. You got a tape? Go ahead, show the tape. I want to see the tape of the greatest bodyguard that has ever been. I don't talk about Secret Service agents. I don't talk about nobody except Big Bubba. You see my Midnight Express in action right now? The rocket launcher on that Bill Mulkey, who just never seems to learn. And what does Randy Mulkey do? Randy Mulkey, his brother, comes in, tries to attack the Midnight Express. He gets dumped right out at my feet. And then Randy Mulkey makes the fatal mistake that Dusty Rhodes has made. He put his hands on me, and Big Bubba took loose, and he threw him in that ring, and he makes a piece of garbage out of him. And Dusty Rhodes, that's the same thing that's going to happen to you at Big Bubba's hands. He's invincible. He's indestructible. He's invulnerable. He can't be beat. He can't be stopped. And Dusty Rhodes, when you lost that world title, it was a bad day. But at least then, you could get out of the ring on your own. Against Big Bubba, you're not going to be able to.
In Japan, the...
Ladies and gentlemen, with us now, the Raging Bull, Manny Fernandez.
You know, Davey Crockett, it's been going around that the Bull ain't been doing much, but baby, guess who's back in circulation? And it ain't for money, Daddy. You know, Paul Jones has been running around the country telling people that I might like his money. Well, I don't like any color money, especially when it comes from people I don't understand or don't believe in being my friend. There's only one man I understand, and that's Boogie Woogie, baby. And before the year's out, like he promised, there won't be somebody bald, and it ain't gonna be me, because I love my hair. And I don't like you, Paul Jones. I promise you, you will be bald. Is that right, Boogie?
Willie, Willie! Willie, Willie! Watch it out, watch it out, watch it out, watch it out! You know something, Paul Jones! You're the dirtiest, you're the sloppiest, you're the lowest creature on earth! You offered my blood! Money, dirty money, it'll never happen! Blood and money don't mix! We coming for your hair!
All right, let's go to the ring. Gorgeous Jimmy Garvin. And precious.
David, you know
he's
something?
Happy today.
This is the nicest looking couple that I've ever seen. They look so happy together. And besides that, they're the nicest looking couple in professional wrestling.
Boy, look
and
look
besides
that, outfit she's wearing.
Precious is looking very, very healthy today. Very healthy today. As a matter of fact, Bubba almost took his sunglasses off. Almost.
Gorgeous Jimmy Garvin and Precious, Tony. Precious is his ego. She builds him up every single day.
You know, it's quite an entrance when you see gorgeous Jimmy and Precious walk in. Say what you will about him, but it is really something. And look at Gorgeous. Doesn't he look happy?
Well, there... Mitch Snow over there in the corner, he's waiting to see if he's going to get to wrestle or just watch people kiss. But I tell you what, knowing how tough gorgeous Jimmy Garvin is, I would bet that he'd rather stand there and watch him kiss Precious than get kissed by Jimmy Garvin.
Let's watch him now. Gorgeous Jimmy.
He's moving out of full scoop slam on Mitch Snow.
He's another newcomer to professional wrestling. He's a good-looking young guy, but he gets his heck on the dance floor and everything, but he better stay out of the ring with gorgeous Jimmy Garvin. You know, Jimmy is just a guy like I am. He's nice, he's plain-spoken, he's quiet, he's modest. He's a guy that I can identify with. He's a lot like me.
He's got pressure.
Well, almost like me. Okay, anyway, now a beautiful move by Jimmy Garvin. Kicks off Mitch Snow, come back up to his feet. And Garvin has an excellent amateur background in wrestling as well as Mitch Snow, so this could be a battle on several fronts, amateur style and professional. Now Snow, good arm drag takedown, and Garvin immediately with that extra added experience converts it to a head scissors. Now they're both up back to their feet. And
listen to Precious. She's out there.
That's right, she's supporting her man. She sticks with one man and she supports him, just like all good women should do.
Got the headlock. Squeezing tighter and tighter.
I myself, I don't need women around to cheer for me. I've got Bubba and the Midnight Express, but some people need that extra added boost. And hey, it's like their cup of tea.
That was a good one.
Beautiful forearm. Put Mitch Snow down, rattled his jaw. And now Jimmy, and he hooks him up in that front face lock. He puts the arm over the head, and Snow's so
here
rattled, he can't escape from it. A beautiful, beautiful brain buster. One, two, three, and that is it. Gorgeous Jimmy Garvin, a beautiful victory over Mitch Snow.
The winner of the match, gorgeous Jimmy Garvin, and Precious right there with his brain buster.
Oh, right down on Mitch Snow. The winner of the match, gorgeous Jimmy Garvin with Precious. And David stands by with Magnum T.A.
Ladies and gentlemen, even though this man lost in the challenge to that United States heavyweight title against Nikita Koloff, we're very proud of you, Magnum.
Well, thank you very much, David Crockett. You know, I feel no shame in standing here before all these people here today without having the United States heavyweight championship in my possession. I'm a man that chose this sport knowing full well there's all kinds of situations you have to deal with. Films can be reviewed and thought about and pondered upon, but no matter what you think about it, the outcome sticks. Nikita Koloff now sports around the United States Heavyweight Championship. The National Wrestling Alliance recognizes him as such. Now I become the man in the chase, not the man holding the belt. And that changes everything, because now you see I have everything to gain and absolutely nothing to lose. So Nikita, all the rematches are signed. They're signed, sealed, and I'm the man that can deliver them. I'm the man that can bring the United States Heavyweight Championship back here to the United States of America. I'm not real happy about the situation, but you backed me up there against the wall. And now I've got to come out fighting. I'm not quitting. I'm not going the other way. I'm coming straight at you the only way I know how. The rematches are not going to be a pretty picture for you, my friend. You're going to find out that belt carries with it a whole lot of weight, a whole lot of troubles. So every day when you get up in the morning, you be thinking about being your best. You be thinking about being that superior athlete that Ivan Koloff has got you all pumped up into thinking that you are. Because without that man behind you, without Crusher Khrushchev behind you, my friend, you're going to find this a cold, cruel world out there. All the wolves come out wanting to tear your throat, and the biggest wolf of them all standing before you right now with that fire still burning in my eyes, all that desire still in my soul, feeling just as good about myself as the day I first won that championship belt. So when you get the chance, you sit down and think about it a little bit, because I don't want you to walk in anything blindly. When I take you out, I take you out clean, by myself, in the middle of the ring, one, two, three. You felt the belly-to-belly suplex one time. You saw what it was like to be helpless. You knew what it was like to hear that referee count, one, two, three, and not be able to move. Well, you're going to see it again, because it's not over yet. It won't be over until I get that belt back around my waist.
All right. That's Magnum T.A. He's on his way. Let's go to the ring.
Oh, Tony.
Nikita, like Magnum said, the big wolf is after you.
Yeah, you can't knock that American down.
I didn't miss anything important. I had to wash my hands. I touched your jacket earlier, David, and you got some kind of grease on it.
Shaska, Whatley.
Oh!
Shaska Whatley on George South and South. Once again, from the opening bell, Shaska, Paul Jones is a master at getting his men fired up just like I am. You see Baron Von Reschke there at ringside for Shaska's moral support as well.
And Shaska Whatley,
just from the opening bell, he has been going after George South, and now, don't talk about the man's bald head.
We've got to.
That's not his fault, but
that's right. It's Paul Jones' fault.
No, it's not.
Making Jimmy
Van. It's Jimmy
Van's
fault. Just like
Jimmy
George
Van
South paid for it with a super
flex. And his army. Shaska puts
well, what's
him down.
He ain't gonna get him, though. Bang, it's a bald-headed geek.
Paul Jones, this might be one before the year's out. There you see, Paul Jones in his army. And that was a quick win for Shaska, and he still pounds George South. The superplex over the middle turnbuckle. Shaska no longer concerned, obviously, about the shaven head. Very confident in the winner of the match, Shaska over George South. Don't go in.
We'll be right back, fans, after these commercial messages about the worldwide wrestling events coming to your area.
The Civic Center in Philadelphia, Saturday, September 6th at 8:30, the NWA returns. The Raging Bull, Hector Guerrero, will take on Ivan Koloff and Crusher Khrushchev. A lumberjack match, Jimmy the Boogie Boogie Man Vine against number one, Paul Jones. The Midnight Express with Jim Cornette will take on Wahoo McDaniel and Captain Redneck Dick Murdoch. And for the U.S. Heavyweight title in a cage, Nikita Koloff, the champion, defense against Magnum T.A. at the Civic Center. Lumberjack match, Paul Jones against Jimmy the Boogie Boogie Man Vine.
You know, Valley, as far as we're concerned,
you're finished. And I'm going to get in a ring with you in Philadelphia. Look at the smile on Shaska's face, because he was part of the plan that cost you your hair.
Now you want to get me in the ring in a lumberjack match?
Well, brother, let me tell you something. You lost your guts when you lost your hair. And I tell you, Shaska's going to be one of the lumberjacks. And what are you going to do when I throw him out to you, Shaska?
I'm going to smack him, kick him, and dog him like he's supposed to be dog. And I'm going to tell you what, Valiant, you ain't so smart no more. Because everybody knows that the Army has taken care of business. And now we're looking forward to humiliating you, Valiant.
Do me one favor. Throw him back in to me.
Hector Guerrero on the Raging Bull will take on Ivan Koloff at Crusher Khrushchev in this cage U.S. heavyweight title match. As you'll see, Magnum T.A. against Nikita Koloff.
Yes. Nephew Nikita has got Magnum where he wants him in Philadelphia. Because last time we were there, Magnum kept running out to the ring, afraid of Nephew Nikita because of his power, because of his strength. You know, Magnum T.A., down deep, that he is superior to you. You found it out during the Great American Bash when you met. And then have you, Nikita, defeated you in best out of seven series for United States heavyweight title. But now, inside the cage, you feel that you're going to get justice back. American justice, you say. You're doing it for the American people. Well, whether it's for your own self, your own greed, or whether it's for the American people, you come ahead, because nephew Nikita, once again, will show you why.
Uncle Ivan, Magatia. I like a cage match. Many people are afraid of this cage. No, Nikita. I'm going to put you face all over this cage.
Yes, this is the truck that's advertised right here.
Ladies and gentlemen, with us, the world heavyweight champion, the Nature Boy, Ric Flair, and his blonde bombshell baby doll.
Woo! The Nature Boy, the blonde bomber, and baby doll. Woo! The blonde bombshell. Why shouldn't the perfect 10 have a perfect 10? You understand? And all you women out there, woo, know what Slick Rick is talking about. You see, Dusty Rhodes, you used to be the world champion. You used to be the American dream. You and Magnum used to have baby doll. But then Slick Rick, woo, and the four horsemen slid in the back door. Said, baby doll, why don't you style a profile, woo, with the real men? Baby doll said, you know, Slick Rick, woo, I always wanted to ride Space Mountain. So say, you know what? I fell in love with the other woman. And baby doll, right now, is standing just where Shattered is standing, next to the World Heavyweight Wrestling Champion, Lifestyle of the Rich and the Famous. You're talking about them. We ride in limousines. We fly in Learjet airplanes. We are the most talked about couple in the world today. And when I get through modifying Baby Doll's wardrobe, she's going to have more clothes and more jewelry than Elizabeth Taylor ever dreamt of having. You know why? Because Ric Flair is a big spender, and Dusty Rhodes wore in his cowboy boots and his blue jeans and his t-shirts, and Magnum, who used to be the U.S. champion, with his skinny little arms and his skinny little neck and his motorcycle parked outside next to my Mercedes-Benz, couldn't get it done. So you see, Baby Doll made it clear to the whole world that she likes bad, 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 bad boys. Woo! Because we make her feel, woo, so good. Woo!
Ladies and gentlemen, that is the World Heavyweight Champion Ric Flair and Baby Doll. Let's go to the ring. In the ring, the World Television Champion, one of the Four Horsemen, Iron Anderson. You look at Iron Anderson, you have to think about Ole Anderson.
That's right. You know, Ole Anderson, there's Keith Patterson, his opponent. Ole Anderson, the man they call the Rock, the cornerstone of that Four Horsemen. And they're, oh my. You can better believe that's something that Ole Anderson handed down to the younger arm.
Don't forget about me.
Oh, hey.
I just finished talking to my mother on the phone. I got a couple of things I will let you know later on, but right now, Arn Anderson looks a little bit surprised at this young Keith Patterson.
There you see Keith Patterson, this young man. Does not have all the experience, but he's got the desire to win.
Well, a lot of people have desire. A lot of people want a lot of things. People in hot places want cold water.
You want to be the World Tag Team Champion.
And we were. For 6.5 months, we were the undisputed greatest team in professional wrestling. And then lightning strikes, a fluke happens. An inexperienced referee who was probably crooked lets them pull the trunks on the illegal man in the ring and score a quick three count. Now,
three
I don't
seconds.
Call that a decisive victory to you. And Arn Anderson right now taking over on Patterson, who had a momentary lapse of talent, but now you see that Arn Anderson has managed to take over and put him right back in his place where he belongs.
Look at Anderson driving that arm. They're famous for working on one part of the body, especially the arm.
Now let me ask you a question, David Crockett. Can you honestly say that the Midnight Express are not one of the most different, most unusual, unique, talented tag teams that you have ever seen? Can
yes,
you honestly say that?
Yes, they are.
Okay, then. Can you honestly say that you call that a decisive victory by the Rock and Roll Express?
This is an Anderson move. Slam him on that arm.
Evading the subject again, I see. Yeah,
no,
it is.
Not.
It's a great move.
The fans out there
it's
want
a
to
great
watch
move by a talented man, the World TV Champion Arn Anderson. You know, like I said, I was just talking to my mother. Do you realize how hard it was for me to explain to Mama that we had lost the belts, regardless of whether it was a fair loss or not? Do you realize how hard it was for me to have to go home? I had to go in person and get
That's
down
terrible.
And tell her that right
Big
down in the fist.
Get out right in the chest.
And it's embarrassing for me to have to tell any of my shortcomings to my mother.
That wouldn't affect your allowance at all. Do you think it would affect his allowance, David?
Shivani, why don't you sit over there with your little Mickey Mouse headphones on and leave the commentating to me and David, who know how,
okay,
or at least
got that
I
arm.
Do.
Got it in tight. Switch now.
Arn Anderson now takes Patterson into the ropes.
Oh.
And there's that beautiful bear hug power slam move.
I like it.
I've got to ask him what he calls that.
I like
that. That is a devastating move. Drives the breath right out of the man. Super, super maneuver by
Arn
Anderson.
Him, but I like that
and
move.
And sets him up. Sets him up for that board buster, and that should be all that she wrote.
Fans like him or not, he's a world television champion, and this man can fight
good at what he does.
When the gourd buster goes on of Arn Anderson's, that's all that there is.
And let's take a look once again at Arn Anderson with a decisive win over Keith Patterson just moments before this gourd buster. That awesome move by Arn Anderson. He was already out when he went down, and he went down face first. The World TV Champion Arn Anderson wins once again. We'll have more right after this timeout.
There is only one dream, and that's the American dream, Dusty Rhodes.
You know, David, it's a very unusual situation that's going on here. Me and you both are watching a lot of things transpire. It's unbelievable. My brother's on the street, the construction worker working in the ditch. I pull up in my Mercedes or my BMW or my Rolls Royce, and the brother said, Dust, say, what is going on, baby doll? Ric Flair. Ric Flair come out here, talk to you, David Crockett. He said, David, baby doll wanted to ride Space Mountain. She's walking around now with the true lover of all the world. David, I don't believe this is a project on women. You understand? I'm talking about lovers and girls. And I got my problem with Big Bubba. Big Bubba trying to put my lights out. It ain't going to happen, Big Bubba. Big Bubba going to find out Dusty Rhodes and McAdree started getting mean and evil. You know, we all can be doctors and lawyers. We can be ambassadors. We can even be the heavyweight champion of the world. But the thing is, David, you know yourself. If me and you want women, we get on the Pride. We fly out to Vegas. We get all the women we want. There ain't nothing wrong about getting women, Nature Boy Ric Flair. Me and David both been on the plane at the drop of a hat and say, Dave, let's have a cool one and let's go to Vegas. Let's go to Monte Carlo. Let's go somewhere and get women. We ain't talking about, when we talking about the world that we're tired, we're talking about the United States that we're tired. We're talking about guys like Jimmy Garvin running around with lady that he calls out of here later the evening, I call it. The thing is, David, what it really boils down to, if we're talking women, me and you can talk with the best of them. If we're talking wrestling, we're talking about Dusty Rhodes, the American Dream. And why you're a wealthy man, Ric Flair, why you're a super wealthy man is because Dusty Rhodes is just a little bit wealthier than you are. And remember tonight when you and Baby Doll pull out in that Mercedes, you're probably leasing. Remember this one thing. It's like an old shoe. Every time you put it on, remember, I've already wore it, Jack.
Jim Cornette, eat your heart out, guy. World Tag Team Champions, the Rock and Roll Express, Robert Gibson and Ricky Morton.
That's right, David. You know, we told Cornette before that we had some business to take care of. And that business is all over with, Cornette. And then we met you in Midnight Express. But you see, Cornette, we didn't give you a chance to interfere, brother. We didn't give you a chance to use that tennis racket because we told you 2-on-2, baby, woo, that we are the best. And I'm talking about the Rock and Roll Express, the new World Tag Team Champions. And you know, David, Cornette had his own opinion. But the film right here today of the match that happened in Philadelphia shows the fact that we won the match. Right here, when Bobby Eaton come off the top rope, that's right, he hurt Robert. He put him out for a couple of days. But let me tell you something. He had enough strength and enough guts in his body to make it through this match because he knew he had to suck down real deep and get it. And brother, right here what we did, Cornette. We're going to show you. You see right here, we didn't give Cornette a chance to interfere. He's out there, he's trying, he's talking. And he's talking about the illegal man. You see Dennis Connors is in the ring right now trying to get my attention. But Bobby Eaton is behind trying to get a hold of Robert, David. But brother, right here, Robert's fighting back. And he shows us what it's all about right here. He digs down. That big knee. Wow!
Right there, Dave, I knew I had to do one thing. I had to tag my partner, because right here, the most important match we've been in a long, long time, the NWA World Tag Team titles. Right here, I make this tag.
And you see, Dennis Connors is a legal man. Dennis Connors is a legal man, not Bobby Eaton. We did not beat the legal man. Brother, we would beat you right there in the middle of the ring, Jimmy Cornette, fair and square. As you can see right here. Reverse suplex, because brother, we knew we was digging down deep. We wanted this match, brother. We wanted to prove to the world that we could beat the Midnight Express anytime, any place. And that's exactly what we did. Drop kick off the top.
Oh, that was a beautiful drop kick. Goes down for that pin. Robert comes in there, grabs him. Then the referee goes with Robert. A lot of confusion there. You have him down. You have him down for the pin right there.
You see, that's the team that Midnight Express are. They're really listening to Jimmy Cornette out there. Bobby Eaton's in the ring right now. Bobby Eaton is not the illegal man. Dennis Connors is out on the floor. That's when Robert grabbed the referee's arm because we knew. And as you see right here, David.
Look at Cornette. He's going berserk. Now, we get that hit. There you see it right there. Knocks you out, Ricky.
Yes, sir.
All right, Robert's over there. He's fighting. Now he has to fight on both men.
You ain't catching. Both men are over right there. I'm digging down deep. I'm hurt. But I know one thing we got to do. We got to beat the Midnight Express. Right there in Philadelphia, David, we did just that.
Right here, you can see, baby, the new NWA World Tag Team Champions, the Rockin' Roll Express. Woo!
That's right, you see it right there. The new World Tag Team Champions, the Rockin' Roll Express, Ricky Morton and Robert Gibson. Let's go to the ring. In the ring, another of the four horsemen, Tully Blanchard.
With J.J. Dillon.
On the count of two, almost got it put out.
You know, they say a picture's worth a thousand words.
I was using a phone, okay? Let's talk about the match in the ring.
Your money, you'd have a mobile phone.
Fight.
Well, I was
good.
Using
what hard right hand by Rocky Cardinal.
What do you think? I got Jesus. My car parked in the corner of the arena in here, you goof. A mobile phone? Demony, let's talk about the match.
Yes,
Tully Blanchard hammering Rocky Cardinal. Hooks him up right there, and if he gets it,
slingshot,
he does.
Suplex,
a slingshot suplex, it's
got
to be all over.
That it is. You're there.
Tully Blanchard Enterprises.
Another one of the four horsemen. Tully Blanchard with J.J. Dillon. The four horsemen really on a roll. We've seen Flair. We've seen Arn. Of course, we talked about Ole Anderson's presence as always, and now James J. as Tully Blanchard. That Tully Blanchard is looking good. The winner of this match, Tully Blanchard. And we're coming right back with more right after this.
No other taste.
215.
Ladies and gentlemen, with us now, the Kansas Jayhawks, Bobby Jaggers and Dutch Mantell.
You know something, David Crockett, it really appalls me to see the things that have gone on around here since we've been here in a short few weeks. Number one, Dusty Rhodes had his title stolen from him, not by one man, Ric Flair, as everybody like Ric Flair, like everybody know, but by a team of four horsemen. Then you look at Magnum T.A., down 3-0, comes back 3-3, and has to fight three men at one time. Well, I'll tell you something, they have nothing to be ashamed of. They're great men, and they're great individual wrestlers, and I'm sure that everybody's going back to where they were before, Daddy, if you know what I mean. But the one thing is, the Jayhawks are here. Russians, we're looking at you, Daddy. You want a piece of us? Come and get a piece of us. Because I'll guarantee you one thing. We got the equalizer. We got Shoe Baby. And there's a few of our friends running around that are getting teamed up on. And I'll guarantee you one thing. Shoe Baby is in the business to help out a lot of people, and our friends included. Right, Dutch?
You ain't kidding us. Shoe Baby's like AT&T. Sometimes it just feels like reaching out and grabbing somebody. Now, there's a lot of people around here that wish the Kansas Jayhawks weren't here, but as long as Dutch Mantell is on the scene and the Hangman Bobby Jaggers, baby, people are going to sit up and take notice. And I'm talking about the Midnight Express, and I'm talking about the Anderson, I'm talking about the Russians, and I'm talking about the whole smiles of people. Because, baby, we are here to go all the way to the top. And I don't care what it takes, we got what it takes to get the job done, baby. We're here, and we're here to stay. Look out for the Jayhawks.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, let's go see the Russians they were talking about. Nikita Koloff, Ivan Koloff, and Crusher Khrushchev. They see Ivan and Crusher hugging, embracing, and you know,
the new United States heavyweight champion.
And it's our first look at Nikita Koloff wearing that belt, and that, you have
makes
to admit, is
sick.
Not a pretty sight at all.
No, it is not.
And let me ask you a question. What is this with Todd Champion and his Jack Jackson wearing these baby blue matching tights? Are they trying to tell us that they're somehow involved as tag partners or more than tag partners? Is that what they're saying to us? Todd Champion now with a beautiful backdrop on Ivan Koloff, but Ivan, a lot of experience, a lot of edge and wisdom in professional wrestling.
Ivan Koloff is the captain, the general of the team. He watches both of his wrestlers all the time.
Look at the power on Crusher Khrushchev. He is one of the strongest men in wrestling, I got to say. He weighs about a good 310, 315, and powerful. Here comes Ivan off the top rope, and they're taking Todd Champion to town right now.
Oh, look at the Champion. Hat picks him up. Looks like he was a kid.
And Champion. Oh, experience element. He went
true.
For that elbow. All Ivan had to do was play possum for a second, roll out of the way. Now he's tagging Crusher. He sends Champion to the ropes and gets him with a double elbow. And Jack Jackson on the outside of the ring, he's looking real thrilled about the prospect of having
there's
to get in there.
There's a mistake on Crusher's part.
He didn't hook him.
He didn't think he had to.
Good kick.
Kick right to Crusher's heart, staggered him, and now Jack Jackson with the headlock, but Crusher, Jackson can't win without 220, and Crusher just belly-to-back suplexed him just like he was a rag doll, picks him up, scoops him up, easily a slam, setting him up for Ivan there, Ivan climbing the turnbuckles, Ivan's starting to look a little bit like Beautiful Bobby today, coming off
here
the
left,
and look at that move, woo! A sickle off the top rope, and that is all she wrote for Jack Jackson.
Look at him.
Right there.
You know, you can tell by watching them in the ring, by the way they act, since Nikita Koloff won that United States heavyweight title, the Russians are really feeling good. Nikita Koloff is in action coming up. Remind you fans of that, and we'll take a look right now as the Russian Bear gets rid of two men. We'll be right back. More action, fans, after these commercial messages about the worldwide wrestling events coming to your area. It's the Civic Center, Philadelphia, Saturday, September the 6th at 8:30. The NWA returns the Raging Bull, and Hector Guerrero will take on Ivan Koloff and Crusher Khrushchev. A lumberjack match. Wrestlers surrounding the ring. Jimmy the Boogie Boogie Man Vine takes on number one Paul Jones. The Midnight Express with Jim Gornett against Wahoo McDaniel and Captain Redneck Dick Murdoch. And in a cage for the U.S. Heavyweight title, Nikita Koloff defense against Magnum T.A. at the Civic Center. Let's bring in Jimmy the Boogie Boogie Man Vine. Lumberjack match against number one Paul Jones.
You know, I demanded it. The fans demanded it. The promotion demanded it. This is all I want, Tony. One more chance, Mr. Paul Jones. Yeah, you did beat me for my hair, but you didn't do it by yourself. Well, this time, you're going to be by yourself with my friends, my people, and all the street brothers, plus all the gangs and clubs in Philadelphia, PA. They're all going to be around the ring. No more running, no more hiding, no more beeping, and no more jiving. And just remember, I am coming for your hair. Hair! Paul Jones, you will be a ball-headed geek before this year is up. It might happen the 6th. Remember, I'm coming.
In this cage for the U.S. heavyweight title, Nikita Koloff defends against Magnum T.A.
Well, the whole wrestling world knows by now that Nikita Koloff has to be recognized as the United States heavyweight champion. We don't have to feel real good about the way he attained it, but that's all historical now. We got to go forward with this thing. And in Philadelphia, we're going to go forward, all right. We're going to go forward right inside this steel cage, the place where you can settle all your differences with no outside interference. You know, you pride yourself on being the most superior athlete in the world. Russia's finest. Well, if you're Russia's finest, you are a nightmare. Because the only way that the big bad man from Russia can get anything done is with a little help from his friends. Well, see, this thing right here assures everyone that they get a fair shake. Nobody gets in, nobody gets out. And it can get real messy when, Nikita, you and I have been to the post on many, many occasions. And now the U.S. heavyweight title on the line around your waist, where you're going to find out what it's like to have the battle brought to you. That's exactly what's going to happen in Philly.
Ladies and gentlemen, back at ringside with Nature Boy Buddy Landell and the superstar Bill Dundee. And guys, you're looking great as always.
Oh, thank you, James. Hey, I'm tired of all the crybabies around here. If it ain't Magnum T.A. here saying all the Russians beat me up. If it ain't Dusty Rhodes saying my knees out, I can't walk. The Four Horsemen and Ric Flair beat me up. It doesn't matter who beat you up. The name of the game is winning. Dusty Rhodes wants to be the world's champion. The Nature Boy wants to be the world's champion. And I just want to beat people up, Jimmy. No, I'm just going to tell you this. Flair, this is a guy that put the Ford in the word figure. Figure four, Daddy. If you're as bad as you say you are, Flair, come on, do it to this one. Rock and roll. You want some competition. Not selling your team short. You got it. All you want. Dusty Rhodes, you ain't number one no more. You wrestle the Nature Boy. Then you can maybe say you beat somebody. Now, Magnum T.A., I'll take you on, Jack, but you can't beat the Russians, so you can't beat this little Aussie. Now, But Joe, we're going to thrill all the girls out there, because they're going to get on the telephone and call somebody and tell them we're out here looking great. So talk to them, Daddy.
Hey, Jimmy, you know, I was driving down the road the other night, and I got this girl in the car, and you know, she was a magician. I've seen her drive that big Mercedes down the road, and she rubs me right here on the leg a little bit, and I turn into a Holiday Inn. Hey, it ain't no secret, baby, that the bogus nature boy Ric Flair can't get the job done, Daddy. It's a fluke. It's a fluke that Dusty Rhodes beat him. Everything's a fluke except for the real deal standing here right now, Daddy. Now, the nature boy was gone for a while. He had an attitude adjustment, Daddy, but I'm back, and I'm back in style, Daddy. When you see that white Mercedes pull up at the back door, Daddy, you know it's time for business. That's here exactly what I'm talking about. That's right. I said it. Tell him, Bill.
That's right. Now, Jimmy, everybody's going to say we're bragging. We ain't bragging, folks. Just sign the dotted line, because he'll sign it, I'll sign it, any kind of match you want with anybody in the whole high world, because we're the best there is.
And now, the United States Heavyweight Champion in the ring.
It is
definitely not Sam Houston.
Sam Houston.
Sam Houston wishes he was the United States Champion.
There you see him.
You know,
Sam's ready. Go ahead, Tony.
The fans really behind Sam Houston. You're right, Sam wishes he was the U.S. Heavyweight Champion. A lot of people gunning after that title. Captain Rendick, Dick Murdoch, you know, he would like that title, but he just liked to get his hand on the Russian.
That's right. Dick Murdoch hates them all.
You know something, David?
He'd like to squeeze your little neck, too.
What? What are you saying? This is going to be interesting. This is going to be real interesting because Nikita Koloff, the United States Heavyweight Champion, Sam Houston, a former Mid-Atlantic champion. But here's the interesting thing. Sam Houston is quicker than Grease Lightning. Sam Houston can turn the light off at night and be in bed before the room gets dark. But Nikita Koloff, Nikita Koloff is the very essence of strength. So the question is, which is going to come out on top? Strength or speed? In my situation, I'm betting on Nikita Koloff. But Sam Houston may be capable of pulling off an upset.
All right, we've seen both so far. We've seen the quickness of Sam Houston and the strength, the power of the Russian nightmare, Nikita Koloff. The nightmare came true. He is the United States Heavyweight Champion.
And as you can tell, the chant of USA really bothers him.
It should.
Really gets under his skin.
And you know something, David, right here, Sam Houston's going to have a hard time hanging on to the headlock, just like I thought.
Look at that.
Because for one thing, Nikita's got that bald head. When it gets sweaty, it gets slippery, and Nikita's got the strength to pick Houston up and fling him right off, just like he did. And Tommy Young, the referee,
Pee
Wee Hunter, the professional wrestling, got caught in the crossfire. Woo! He nearly took his head off with that one, David.
Now look, he doesn't even try to pin him. He's enjoying this. He wants to embarrass.
Oh, sure. Sam Houston's an American. Houston is from the great American state of Texas. Just what he wants to embarrass. Nikita wants to embarrass the Americans. And Houston right now is in a bad way, and Nikita knows he's got the advantage. But on the other hand, the egg would be on Nikita's face if Houston was able to make a successful cross counter. What's he doing? Look at that.
Knee right in the middle, knocks the wind out.
The key, like Ivan's I said, outside. Houston's going to have to use his speed because Nikita's too big and too powerful, and he's
that
got him outweighed by 80 pounds.
You can see him. Ivan always shouting instructions. Nikita is his man. Ivan's brought him all the way. All the way up to the United States Heavyweight Champion now. A well-disciplined
look at him, look at Houston. The guy is just not going to quit. He is not going to give it up, but with Nikita's power, it could be too much for him. Now look, is Nikita saying, look, Nikita's watching him, waiting for him to get up. If he's setting up for that sickle.
Ivan's over there, he's right telling him.
Ivan told him to do something. Yeah, right there. The Russian sickle, if Sam Houston gets up from that, I'll be greatly surprised. Strength and speed, strength won out in this case.
Put him down. Go to pin. Oh, David, he's picking him back up. Oh, look at him.
Unbelievable!
I have never seen anything like it! Nikita Koloff, one of the biggest men in wrestling!
Nikita Koloff down on the mat. Out! Hands a stone rod, Garvin KO. Run! Congratulations! Thank you very much.
Well, I'm going to tell you, David, I'm standing here watching this, and after a man beats a man, he should leave him alone. I'm not going to stand for that because Sam Houston's a friend of mine. I'm going to tell you, Nikita Koloff, you might be a nightmare, but you don't scare me. And the fact is that the United States Heavyweight Champion, you are. And you're looking at a United States citizen that's going to take it away from you. I'm very well qualified for the job. I usually don't interfere in people's matches, but the match was over. I took it under my own hands to help a friend, but Nikita, you're called a nightmare, but I'm going to tell you, before you have a nightmare, you got to start dreaming. Well, in your dreams, you're going to see Ronnie Garvin. And they're going to turn into a nightmare for Nikita Koloff. And I'll promise you that. Now, a lot of people have backed down from you, but I'm going to tell you something. You're looking at a man right here. You've been barking loud. Well, you come and bite. You take, you sink your teeth into this American citizen, and I'm going to show you. I'm going to remove your teeth.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, that's Ron Garvin, hands of stone. Nikita, he got it for you. We'll see you next week on the very best in professional wrestling, Worldwide Wrestling.
Worldwide Wrestling is a presentation of the JCP Sports Network and has been furnished to the station for broadcast at this time by Jim Crockett Promotions in exchange for commercial consideration.
People think that I'm cocky, but I feel this way. If I can't beat everybody I wrestle, then I don't deserve to be the champion. I'm going to wrestle anybody, the contract sign, I don't care where it is, LA, New York, here, Greensboro, Phoenix, Bloomington, Minnesota, Houston, Texas, I don't care. Whoever I wrestle, I guarantee you one thing, when they get in the ring with me, they're going to say one thing. I might not be the greatest wrestler in the world, but I'm going to be the toughest and the best champion that I can possibly be. And I can tell you one thing, and anybody gets there with me is going to walk out of that ring. They're going to have some dents in their armor.
The national champion, Wahoo McDaniel fans, let's go to the ring. And we're going to watch an action. There he is, the man that Wahoo defeated for that championship, Tully Blanchard. And in his corner, of course, Mr. James J. Dillon. Tully Blanchard, who's a opponent in this match, is Tony Zane. Tully Blanchard has held a championship for a long time, the national champion, the world television championship, Jim Cornette. Now he's without a championship. How do you think it's going to affect him?
He won't be without a championship for long, Bob Caldwell, because I know Tully Blanchard, and more importantly, I know James J. Dillon also, being a colleague of mine, one of the greatest minds of professional wrestling. And you see, Tully, he is a man who collects championships like some people collect stamps, and he's going to find either that one or another one, I can guarantee that, but I think he's going to have that national championship back, because I saw the match in the Forum in Los Angeles. It was a fluke win, just like when my Midnight Express lost the belts to the Rock and Roll Express. It was a fluke win that Wahoo McDaniel got that title in the first place. I thought it should never have happened. And James J. Dillon tried to tell the referee what had happened, but the referee wouldn't listen to him. Can you believe somebody not listening to a man like James J. Dillon?
Oh, yeah, I can, when you got one tough Indian like Wahoo McDaniel across the ring.
Let me tell you something. Wahoo McDaniel is a tough man. But he don't have any brains, I don't think. And you see Tully Blanchard as a thinking man. And you see James J. Dillon, like I said, a brilliant man. Between the two of them, they would have outsmarted that Indian if it hadn't been for the fact that it was a fluke and the referee was against them. You know these California people. It was probably a California referee. No telling what was wrong with him, if you know what I mean.
All right, Tully Blanchard quickly on his feet. And Tony Zane also up. And Tully's going to get a few words of advice right here, as you say, from the brains of the organization there, Mr. James J. Dillon.
Well, J.J. Dillon has been very, very good for Tully Blanchard's career. And, of course, Tully, being the champion that he is, has advanced J.J. Dillon's reputation quite a bit in professional wrestling. So it's been a very good association for the both of them. And right now, it hadn't been good for Tony Hurricane Zane, who has been bearing the brunt of Tully Blanchard's attack. And, yeah, he got him.
Move of Tully Blanchard.
The slingshot suplex is going to be that for Mr. Zane.
Blanchard, when he slingshots you off of the ropes, it's curtains for you, and it was right there for Tony Zane. And we're going to get to see that victory by Tully Blanchard in slow motion. A slingshot maneuver by Tully Blanchard and a slingshot suplex, the winner of the match. Tully Blanchard, as we see James J. Dillon, the head of Tully Blanchard Enterprises, in the ring, the winner, Tully Blanchard.
And ladies and gentlemen, without any further ado, here they are, the one and only gorgeous Jimmy Garvin and Precious.
Don't bother spraying, don't bother spraying, Squeeze. We're going to have to get some stronger stuff than that, because let me tell you something, Magnum T.A. and Dusty Rhodes, mostly you, Magnum T.A., you sick individual. I heard what you were out here telling all these people. If she wouldn't have held me back, I would have came out here and smacked your face. And if you got any guts at all, you'll come out here right now, because I'll make up for it and I'll smack your face now. Now, the fact is this guy thinks he's some kind of brain surgeon or something. He says he doesn't know of any major titles that gorgeous Jimmy Garvin has held. Well, I'm really not even going to get into it, man, because it don't matter, and it just don't matter, because you're in a lot of trouble, son. You're in a lot of trouble. All that male dancing you used to do back in San Francisco, you better get in shape, because you're going to have to do some dancing with the greatest wrestler in the world. Another scoop, by the way, for the fans that are getting buffaloed by a guy named Magnum T.A. Do you know who his stepfather is?
No.
Dusty Rhodes. Dusty Rhodes, that's right, he's a stepchild. Let me tell you something, Magnum, when I get finished with you, they're gonna call you Caliber 22, because it ain't my fault I'm the greatest wrestler in the world, but it is my fault that I'm after you and you only. Where's he at? I'm right here. He's a chicken, that's right, or he'd be out here.
We've got a Mid-Atlantic Championship match and more today. Don't go away.
I'm here.
Christmas is over and you thought you were all through giving presents. Wrong. Up pops Groundhog's Day, Uncle Randolph's birthday, and little Rodney's graduation. No matter what the occasion, I know my 85-86 limited edition lithographs of Larry Bird, Robert Parrish, Kevin McHale, and Danny Ainge will be the perfect gift. They're hand-signed and numbered by me. And here's how you get your set of four.
Hey, hockey fans, there's no need to pack away your skates for the summer, because Sports Channel keeps the hockey action on ice all summer long with Whalers Encore, our weekly replay of a select Whalers game of the week. Now you can relive the Hartford Whalers' most successful season. See key Adams Division matchups and exciting playoff action. Game 4 of the Stanley Cup Adams Division Finals match the Whalers and the Canadiens on Hartford's home ice, Wednesday, September 10th at 8.
Fans, here he is, the world heavyweight champion, the Nature Boy, Ric Flair, and Baby Doll.
And
Rick.
Baby Doll, that's right. Big things happen all over the wrestling world. Bob Caudle, as you know, I've had the opportunity to sit in the back room here, watch the monitor, see Magnum T.A., Dusty Rhodes, Jimmy Garvin, Wahoo McDaniel, all the greats in our sports, really a parade of champions, walk out here and express themselves, talking about me, talking about Baby Doll, talking about the Four Horsemen, and why not? Magnum talking about Nikita. You see, the situation right now is this. Jimmy Garvin, you are a great wrestler. You got a beautiful woman with you, but you haven't got a belt. Magnum T.A., You're a great wrestler, a tremendous background, but you haven't got a belt. Dusty Rhodes, three times former World Heavyweight Champion, one of the greatest of all time in our sport, but you haven't got a belt. And when you go to the bank, brother, they say one thing. They say he's a champion or he's a wrestler. In my case, they always call me the champ. I am Ric Flair. Blanchard, always a champion. The Andersons, always champions. Rock and Roll Express, a couple of punk kids right now holding the titles. But you know that when the Andersons get them in the ring, the belts will belong to them. Now, Buddy Landell. The whole world knows they call me Space Mountain, Slick Rick. What do the girls call Buddy Landell, baby doll?
Rick, I've heard they call him Ride the Wild Mouse.
Ride the Wild Mouse. That's it, Landell. That sums it up. You're looking at Ric Flair and baby doll, and believe me, we're going to be here, woo, for a long, long time. Woo.
Has the dawn of 1986 made you yawn? Well, fasten your seatbelts. Inside NASCAR is back. Ned Jarrett, Steve Burns, and the rest of the Inside NASCAR crew take you behind the scenes, bringing you the stories and the people who make them happen. Inside NASCAR, life in the fast lane. The 1986 Winston Cup season is right around the corner, and so is Inside NASCAR. Inside NASCAR puts you in the driver's seat.
I did not consider safety.
My brakes failed.
I wasn't in the water for more than a minute.
It didn't seem that far up the ladder.
I wasn't wearing my seatbelt.
The waves hit me.
The branch knocked the ladder right out from under me.
The car ran off the road.
I shattered my back.
Now I'm totally paralyzed. It happened in 1 second.
The accident could have been prevented.
Once it happened, there's nothing you can do.
For a free booklet on safety, write to me, Frank Gifford, at the Will Rogers Institute, White Plains, New York.
And back with Jim Cornette and Big Bubba. Jim, I understand, already signed in Atlanta. We've got a great tag team tournament coming up shortly.
You know, the national tag team title had to be vacated a while back because of the Andersons, Ole Anderson having an injury, so they're going to have a tournament for the newly crowned United States Tag Team Championship. It's going to be in the Omni in Atlanta, Bob, and I've already got my boys entered because let me just say this. Like I've said before, I'll say it a million times, it was a fluke win when we lost the belts to the Rock and Roll Express. It was nothing but mere happenstance. So what we're going to do, we're going to get in that tournament for those United States Tag Team title, second in importance only to the World Tag Team Championship. We're going to win that tournament. We're going to beat every team that enters. We're going to prove that we are sheer domination in action as far as tag team wrestling is concerned. And then, when we're the United States Tag Team Champions, those cowardly Rock and Roll Express, they're not going to be able to run. They're not going to be able to hide for us anymore. They're going to have to put the belts up on the line against the Midnight Express again. And when they do, then we're going to have the United States Tag Team Championship over our shoulder. And we are going to have that World Tag Team Championship around our waist. And everybody that watches professional wrestling, regardless of who it is and regardless of how they're connected, is going to have to look up at the pinnacle of success that we're standing on. And they're going to say the Midnight Express are the greatest tag team that there has ever been in the history of professional wrestling. U.S. Tag Team Champions and World Tag Team Champions, we're going to take it all. The first step is that tournament in the Omni in Atlanta.
All right, and talking about champions, fans, we got a championship match in the ring. Let's go to the ring now. Here is Big Black Bart, our Mid-Atlantic champion, and a title match against the man with the hands of stone, Ronnie Garvin, Jim.
Well, this is going to be a good one, Bob, and you know, for several weeks now, I believe it was the last time that Black Bart had defended the title on television. We were saying that Mid-Atlantic Championship has been a stepping stone to a lot of major contenders in their careers. Ric Flair, the first championship that he won in professional wrestling was the Mid-Atlantic title. Wahoo McDaniel earlier in his career held the Mid-Atlantic title. The list goes on and on. It's been a very important stepping stone for the World Heavyweight Championship. Isn't that right, Bob?
You're 100% right, Jim. And here at the bell, action as Bart misses his Garvin duck right under him, and Black Bart went all the way to the ropes. He keeps trying to back Garvin to the corner and to the ropes. And a man that big and that powerful, you don't want to get between him and the ropes and have no place to go, Jim.
Well, you know, Black Bart, and he is just missing Garvin all over the place. Black Bart has held this title and defended this title successfully because he's a big, rough man. He has fought, he has scratched, he has gouged his way to keeping that Mid-Atlantic title. And in this case, Ronnie Garvin has much the same style. Ronnie Garvin's rough. Ronnie Garvin will fight you to the very last bell. So you got sort of a clash of the same styles in this match. And it's only going to be a question of who's the toughest. I'm just glad we got it here on television so all the people all over the country can see it.
Bart with a hair slams Garvin in the mat. Jim, even though Bart is so big and so strong, Garvin can turn his lights out with that right hand. He's that strong and that powerful and that fist is that hard.
Sure, if he hits him from behind, he can turn his lights out in a second, because that's exactly what Ronnie Garvin does, sucker punches. You saw what happened with Nikita Koloff. Do you think he could knock Nikita Koloff out if he hit him head on? He couldn't knock Nikita Koloff out, and he can't knock Black Bart out right here on NWA Pro Wrestling or anywhere else unless he does it from behind with a sucker punch that he always uses.
Jim, I'm going to have to differ with you on that, because I've seen Ronnie Garvin do it time and time again.
Well,
and I know he has the power to do it.
We differ in a lot of ways. I got taste in clothes. You don't. I'm good looking. You're not. So, hey.
You know, some of us have got it and some haven't, Jim. That's all there is to it.
You're a classic case of not having it, Bob. And right now, Ronnie Garvin throwing those chops. And what he's doing is he's making the big man mad. He is making Black Bart hot, but he also put him right down on the canvas.
And Bart, falling down backwards, hits the man hard. But you saw how quickly he bounced back to his feet, and now he's got Garvin in the corner.
That's what I told you about Black Bart being tough. You give him something, he's going to throw it right back in your face, and Ronnie Garvin had just better be able to withstand the pressure, or elsewise he's going to come up short right here on television, and that wouldn't look too good on Ronnie Garvin's record, because he's a top contender for all kind of titles, like the United States title held by Nikita Koloff and Ric Flair's World Heavyweight title.
I'll tell you, Black Bart covers that championship. He's going to defend it any and every way he can, but look at Garvin come back out of the corner. There's a right hand.
Garvin's throwing those chops and some jabs, and now they both got each other's hair. They're pulling back in the turnbuckles, and Ronnie Garvin, a much smaller man, but he uses those ropes to get a height advantage on Black Bart. He's gouging his face, and look at Bart.
Boy, you think they both don't want this championship?
A reverse atomic drop, I guess, would be the most polite name for that move, but whatever it was, it put Ronnie Garvin flat on his back, and now Bart's ripping away at him in the ropes.
Fans, we're delighted to be bringing you this championship match on NWA Pro Wrestling. As we said at the beginning, the most exciting hour in television. And Jim, this match is certainly bearing that out.
Well, referee Tommy Young's got his hands full trying to keep these two guys within the confines of the rules. And right now, the crowd's cheering for Ronnie Garvin, but that's not going to do much good for him inside the squared circle where Black Bart has got him at a disadvantage. And he's got his arm draped over those ropes. And he's head-butting the shoulder, trying to dislocate the joint, Bob.
Well, if he can get on the arms and get the arms injured, he can sure take away the power of Ronnie Garvin in those blows.
And now look at referee Tommy Young once again trying to pull Black Bart back, but he throws a short right to the jaw. Garvin's wheeling in the corner. He can't even put his guard up because he's been stunned. And now pounding on, he is working on both those shoulders, Bob.
And
he is trying to take both the arms away.
And Jimmy, looks like he's going to stay right there and continue to work on the arm.
Now, wait a minute. Garvin reverses it. Comes up with a wrist lock and a twister, but Black Bart. I think the referee saw it, but it's too late. Garvin gets the head scissors and breaks it up. Bart had pulled the hair.
As Garvin met him right head on, drives him backwards, and stands him up on his head. Count of two, as he had both shoulders of the mat thrown at two. There's a lot of fight left in the big man yet, though, Jim.
Oh, there's no way that Ronnie Garvin's going to get a pinfall on Black Bart in the position he's in right now. What Garvin's trying to do is buy some time, because he was stunned. He was hurt by what Bart had done to him earlier, so he's trying to keep his weight down on Bart, get some rest at the same time. Bart got to the ropes to break it up, and now Garvin, he is having to attack Black Bart, or elsewise Black Bart's going to attack him.
That right hand by Garvin, you can hear it echo all over the arena. It was some blow.
Once again, you see Garvin with the front face lock. He's bearing all his weight down on Black Bart. He's trying to blow the big man up, trying to keep Bart from being able to breathe freely. Now hooks up with a chin lock and bringing that head back. Now Garvin is getting a couple of seconds of breath here. At the same time, he's trying to wear Bart's stamina down. And with the bigger man, Garvin is probably likely to have more stamina.
He's got a lot of pressure on that chin and that chin lock. He's almost got Bart over backwards with that. He's put so much pressure on that chin.
And now he clubs him to the chest and he hooks up on that chin lock again.
This is for the Mid-Atlantic Championship fans. Huh. The champion on his knees right now, Big Black Bart.
Look at that. Ronnie Garvin has the point of his knee right at the base of Bart's skull, and he's pulling back on that chin lock. And what is it? Give me a lever and I can move the world. Well, he's fixed to move Bart's head right off his shoulders.
Yeah, Jim, the neck is just not made to bend that way, and Garvin was bending it back, but you saw Bart with a good counter.
Well, Bart had to do something because Garvin was really pressing him there. He had to get out of it some way, and now a short compactor on the arm, and he cranks up with the arm bar again. Like I said, Garvin is in tremendous physical condition. That's all you can say, and Garvin's got to have more stamina than Bart, so Bart's really trying to press that attack because he knows that over the short term, he's going to have that advantage over Garvin because of his size.
And he's going to use that weight every way he can to his advantage. He's going to lean on Garvin, and he's going to make Garvin carry that weight as much as he can, Jim.
I don't know whether that was Garvin's wife in the audience we just caught a shot of or what, but regardless, Ronnie Garvin back up to his feet. Bart's still hanging onto that arm bar with bulldog tenacity, but Garvin may be trying now to put the forearm across the chin and press Bart back, and no, he falls backwards. Use Bart's own weight against him. He put him right over, but Bart's right back on the attack.
And for a man the size of Black Bart, he gets around awfully quick. He very quickly was back on his feet and back on the attack again.
Well, that's the way that he won the Mid-Atlantic Championship. It's a prestigious title, and you don't win it by not having a certain amount of ability that maybe it doesn't look like you've got. Bart doesn't look like a quick man, but he moves quickly. That's what some of his opponents underestimate him about.
Black Bart, who's held that Mid-Atlantic Championship for some time now, and he's determined that he's not going to give it up without one tremendous struggle, and he's in one right now with Ronnie Garvin. And fans, we're going to continue with the action in the ring as this match will continue.
More action, fans, after these commercial messages about the NWA Pro Wrestling events coming to your area.
In the ring, fans, Ronnie Garvin and Big Black Bart for the Mid-Atlantic Heavyweight Championship. And Jim Cornette, it looks right now like Ronnie Garvin has really turned the tide on Big Black Bart, and he's got Bart in trouble in the corner.
Well, all during the time that we've been gone, Bob, Garvin and Bart have been sticking to their respective strategies. Bart has just been trying to plow ahead and beat and club Garvin any way that he could because he's not a pretty wrestler. He's kind of rough. Garvin, on the other hand, has been trying to use that technique and that science that he uses so well to wear Bart down. So it's been nip and tuck. No real advantage during the break. Just a heck of a match, and it's still going on.
And with that leg and that foot now, boy, Garvin is really putting some pressure on it, and you can hear Bart yell all over the arena.
Look at that. Look at that close-up. Ronnie Garvin's boot right underneath Black Bart's chin, and I guess that proves that Black Bart is not just another pretty face.
Jim, it's interesting to see how Garvin has that set up. He's got one foot under the chin of Bart, the other one back behind the back, and that way he's got all that leverage on that back and on that neck, also that knee.
Well, you got to give Ronnie Garvin this. He's got some sadistic tendencies, I think, because he's always devising these new methods of tying people up, and most of them work. But right now, there you go. Bart took the easy way, and hey, when you're defending a title, easy way is the best way. He went to the eyes on Garvin, and now he's hammering that arm once again, chopping him across the chest, takes him with the arm and whips him into the turnbuckles on the far side of the ring, and Garvin takes the fall right down to the canvas.
Boy, that was a vicious chop from Bart as he had Garvin in a corner, and he slammed him into that corner, into the turnbuckles.
Woo!
Garvin almost went out.
Bart caught him again, busy back over the ropes, the big broad arm. This looks like a telephone pole, Bob. Right to the chest, measures him up for another one. He is hammering on Ronnie Garvin, and that's where that size of Bart comes into play, too. About a 65, 70-pound weight advantage. He's got those big broad arms that he can do anything with to Garvin.
Boy, you're talking about sore tomorrow. These two are really going to know they've been in a fight. It's been like a street fight in that ring.
Both of them are staggering, but I think Black Bart has the definite advantage right now, and Ronnie Garvin's time is slipping away. If he wants to be the Mid-Atlantic Heavyweight Champion, if he wants to prove something on national television, because, you know, Garvin has been searching for, among others, that United States Heavyweight title. A lot of controversy between him and Nikita Koloff, and if he was the Mid-Atlantic champion, that would put him in automatic line for a lot of United States title deep matches with Nikita Koloff.
Bart ripping and clawing at the eyes and ripping at the mouth of Garvin, working on that face, is going to lift him high up on the power slam.
What's Bart going to do? He measures him up and drops that fist right into the face. Bart thinks he has him now. I don't know. He got a two count, maybe a two and a half, but that wasn't quite enough for Ronnie Garvin. I didn't think it would be, much as I got to say that I'm hoping Black Bart comes out on top. It's going to take more than that to take Ronnie Garvin out. Now look, they're just ripping and pulling away at the hair, eyes, face, anything to get a hold of. Bart scores with a big knee lift.
The knee lift sends Garvin back to the mat, but when he comes over, Garvin again waiting on him. Got both feet right up under the chin of Bart. It has been tooth and nail since the opening bell.
Garvin snatches a headlock. Bart sends him into the ropes, drop down. Garvin jumps over it, and they both go down, steam engined each other, and Garvin looks. Garvin was almost the first one up, but he fell back over. Now the referee, Tommy Young, making that double count. If it reaches 10, the match is going to be declared no contest. But no, wait a minute. Bart is getting up to his feet. Black Bart, the bigger man, the first one up.
There was some collision, fans. Both of them were reeling from it. Bart got to his feet, and then Garvin. And down goes Bart as Garvin reached down to grab that leg.
Garvin splashes him, but he only got a two count.
I thought we had a new champion right there.
It's going to take more than that to take Black Bart out as well, Bob Caudle. And now Garvin back on the offensive. Bart has him covered. He got a shoulder up. Bart needs to grapevine that arm, hook the leg, do something to keep Garvin pinned down. Now Bart goes to that reverse chin lock. He's got Garvin winded, and once again, maybe because Black Bart's the bigger man, like we said earlier in the match, he may need a breather. Both of these men, I think, do at the pace they've been going.
Again, he's putting all that weight and all that pressure now on Ronnie Garvin. And Garvin back down to the mat. It takes a lot out of Garvin each time he has to get up off of that mat, Jim.
Yeah, and it makes it even sweeter when Bart takes that little shortcut and just puts him right back down again.
Yeah, what you call the shortcut, by the hair or by the tights. Some way that's definitely against the rules.
This man's defending a wrestling championship. He's not conducting an etiquette class. And Bart with a big body slam. And now, wait a minute, is he going to do it? He's good enough. Oh, yeah, he's turning down. Yeah. And he wants in position just the right way. He's going to the ropes. The Texas Crash Compactor.
Oh, he missed it. He missed it. He took too long. He went around the set.
Champion, you have to defeat Nakita. Nikita don't have to defeat you, tell ya. No, Nikita, you know Ron Garvin, Americans like you make me sick. You think you are superior to Nephew Nikita? You think you are tougher, that you are a greater wrestler? No, you are not. 1 week ago, you came into Nikita's match. You attacked him. You punched him in the face. You knocked him down when he was not looking. But now we had the whole week to think about it, to plot our strategy for our revenge against you. Yes, it was a premeditated thing that we did against you. We knew that you were fortunate enough to defeat Black Bart for Mid-Atlantic title, that your defenses would be down. And we capitalized on this. And if that just be a warning to all you Americans, Captain Redneck, Dick Murdoch, Wahoo McDaniel, new national title holder, and you, Magnum T.A., I hear you out there yelling how you're going to get back United States heavyweight title that is yours. You are wrong. It is not yours. It is Nephew Nikita's United States heavyweight champion. You have to come after him for it. And not least, but most of all, the great American dream, Dusty Rhodes. Because I know you are the ringleader. You are the one that gets all these Americans stirred up. Don't you plan to come after. You better discourage all your friends from coming after. Nephew Nikita is United States heavyweight champion. He's going to remain so.
All right. Title change, and that's all the time.
That's right, a title change. Ronnie Garvin being helped out of the ring as the new Mid-Atlantic champion. See you next week. Until then, so long for now.
Bye-bye.
NWA Pro Wrestling is a presentation of the JCV Sports Network and has been furnished to the station for broadcast at this time by Jim Crockett Promotions. In exchange for commercial consideration.
Professional wrestling. That is worldwide wrestling. I'm David Crockett and Tony Schiavone. We have three new champions. That's right, three. To start off with, we saw it right there. Ron Garvin is the new Mid-Atlantic heavyweight champion.
Defeating Black Bart for that honor, but that's not all. Denny Brown has regained the NWA World Junior Heavyweight title with a win over Mr. Electricity Steve Regal. But we have a new national heavyweight champion, and it took place, David, in the Forum in Los Angeles, California.
That's right. We were there, and 11,000 people witnessed Chief Wahoo McDaniels defeat Tully Blanchard for the national heavyweight title.
And to claim his stake as the number one contender for Ric Flair's NWA World Heavyweight title. A very exciting moment for Chief Wahoo McDaniel, for all the new champions that we have.
That's right, Tony. Now, we need to get over here and talk to our co-host, Jim Cornette.
Let me just say one thing. I got a lot of big things in store for the professional wrestling fans this show, but I will say this. Dusty Rhodes, my man Big Bubba's still looking for you, and when he looks, he finds somebody, and he's going to find you at Rock and Roll Express. We're going to get our World Tag Team Championship back because you never won it fair. You never won it square. All it was a fluke. It was a flimsy fluke. That's all it was, because you can never, ever top the greatest tag team in wrestling. I'm talking about my Midnight Express. So we're coming after those World Tag Team title, and also the big United States Tag Team title tournament. That's going to be good as ours, because that's a stepping stone to the world title. Rock and Roll Express, Dusty Rhodes, everybody, watch out. And you're going to see my men in just a minute.
That's right, we're going to see the Midnight Express. Now, let's talk to the former National Heavyweight Champion, Tully Blanchard and J.J. Dillon.
Don't introduce him as the former National Heavyweight Champion. He's not known as that. This man is known as the man that put the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes, flat on his back, clutching his knee in agony, which eventually was his downfall in defending the World's Heavyweight Championship. Let's tell it like it is, right?
I'll tell you what, David Crockett, you start referring to me as the man that cost Dusty Rhodes everything in the world that he holds dear. That World's Heavyweight Championship belt. And you know, Dusty Rhodes, you may call it planned, you may think the horsemen set the whole deal up, but the fact of the matter is, Dusty Rhodes, the horsemen don't have to make plans to take down the American Dream. I had to go to Kansas City to buy some new threads, and that's the bottom line. You were just icing on the cake. Ha, as it were, wouldn't you say, James J?
That's right, and Dusty, we know you're coming. We don't have to hide the fact we know you're coming. We don't know when, we don't know where, but I guarantee you, when you come, we will be ready.
All right, let's go to the ring, and Jim Cornette.
Ladies and gentlemen, the true, the real tag team champions of the world, Rubber Boy Dennis and Beautiful Bobby, the Midnight Express.
I don't think the fans buy that for a minute.
They know that the Rock and Roll Express are the World Tag Team Champions, no matter what Mr. Cornette says. Good move by Loverboy Dennis. This team, the Midnight Express, they are good. They are very good. Mr. Cornette spent his mother's money very well. Beautiful Bobby, watch him. He's the best anywhere by coming off that top rope and destroying his opponent. Puts a knee right into the midsection. Dennis is in now to make that tag. Teamwork, this team has got it. Watch it. Here he goes. The rocket launcher puts him down for the pin.
With Jim Cornette. Another way out here on Worldwide Wrestling with what they call their rocket launcher. We take a look once again at Sharif Lynn. Down hard goes Vernon Deaton. From that blow from Loverboy Dennis, and Beautiful Bobby up on the top turnbuckle. And then launched off right on top of Vernon Deaton. The Midnight Express with Jim Cornette and Big Bubba. Your winners, and David Crockett has the Russians.
Hi, ladies and gentlemen. We're here with the awesome Russian team. Crusher Khrushchev, Ivan Koloff, and the Russian Nightmare, Nikita Koloff, the United States Heavyweight Champion.
A couple minutes from now, we're going to see VTR and how this Ron Garvin defeated Black Bart for Mid-Atlantic title. That makes you contender for United States Heavyweight title, Ron Garvin. But I want you to take warning, and every other wrestler to take warning. If you mess with the Koloff family, if you try to jump on Koloff family, this is what will happen to you.
All right, let's show the fans right now exactly what you men did to Ron Garvin. They see it right there. Garvin takes Black Bart, that hand of his, put him down.
Illegal move whenever you use fists to punch somebody. Like he tried to punch Nephew Nikita, or did punch Nephew Nikita in the face when he was not looking. But you see, you keep watching, and you watch what happens to this Ron Garvin. He's going to be left in his own slime, in his own slobber, where he belongs, in the middle of the ring. Whenever people like him, people like Wahoo McDaniel, you see that? You see, he's punching again. But you see,
hey, what do you
watching.
Mean? All three of you men go after. What do you expect? What do you want
after
him to do?
After what he did to Nephew Nikita last week, he deserves what he gets. All week we've been thinking of ways of getting revenge against him. Now, you're going to see Nephew Nikita come off a sickle. You see this here? That's his superior athlete right there. Wahoo McDaniel talks about now that he is national title holder, heavyweight champion, that he is number one contender to Ric Flair. But that is not true. He is number one to contender to United States belt, the Nephew Nikita holds. Nephew Nikita is number one contender to Ric Flair and world title.
Nephew 11, I hope this Garvin and all you other stinking wrestlers, I hope you learn from this. You're going to attack Nikita. You see, Nikita can attack too, but there's a big difference. You going to get hurt. You want USA title. I ready. Come for me.
We'll be back with more action right after this. Heavyweight champion Ric Flair and Baby Doll.
You know, David Crockett, there are times in my life when I wonder just how great can Ric Flair get. I've won the World Heavyweight Championship on four different occasions. It's a well-known fact that I recognize as one of the financial powers in the world today. I'm always accompanied by beautiful women wherever I go, and I obviously am the envy of every wrestler in our sport today, outside of the Four Horsemen, because obviously they're my equal. Tully Blanchard, the Andersons, Ric Flair, James A. Dillon, names that make you and your family, Jim Crockett Promotions, and the National Wrestling Alliance proud, because we are champions. Nikita Koloff, the man who knows no law. He is the new U.S. champion. I don't like Koloff, but the fact is he beat Magnum T.A. and now he's the U.S. champion. Wahoo McDaniels, another great athlete, the national heavyweight champion. All these guys standing in line wanting to wear this. Because, David, after all, this is what our sport is all about. Dusty Rhodes, Magnum T.A., Ronnie Garvin. The list is endless of guys that want to be the World Heavyweight Champion. But the bottom line is, Big Dust, if it's Baltimore, Richmond, Atlanta, Georgia, Chicago, Minneapolis, Minnesota, Green Bay, Wisconsin, Phoenix, Arizona, Kansas City, Missouri, when I walk that aisle, you know that you're facing the greatest wrestler of all time. And you know what? It's going to stay that way for a while, because I say so. Woo!
The World Heavyweight Champion, Ric Flair and Baby Doll. Now let's go to the ring.
You know, as we look at the Kansas Jayhawks getting ready for action, Bobby Jagger's in the ring, we think about United States Tag Team Championship Tournament coming up very soon at the Omni in Atlanta.
That's right. It is for United States Tag Team Title.
I've been thinking about it too, David.
I bet you have.
I've been putting a lot of thought into it, and I'm going to win the thing. Me and my boys, the Midnight Express.
Those titles...
Are you going to get in the ring?
Those titles, the former national... Tag Team Championships, and the name was changed.
That's right, and Ole Anderson, who had an injury, had to vacate that title. They never lost him in the ring, so the Andersons, they're going to be front runners for the thing, but I know that the Midnight Express, they're going to take those titles, because that's going to enable us to get back at the Rock and Roll Express for the World Tag Team Championship. And the Kansas Jayhawks, they've been making a lot of noise about whether they could take the Midnight Express or not. I don't think they can. I don't think they're going to be able to. We're going to make chicken hawks out of them.
Watch the teamwork right here. The Kansas Jayhawks, they put it together. They're doing very well, wrestling as a tag team.
Sure, they're doing very well, but they're not in there with the Midnight Express, and I think a confrontation between the Kansas Jayhawks and the Midnight Express would be most enlightening, David.
That can be arranged.
I bet it can. And you know something else? The Jayhawks say that they're from Kansas, that they uphold the rights and the will of all the farmers out there in the farm belt. Well, I don't like farmers myself. I don't think much of farmers because they got mud on their boots and they're dirty and they're stinky and they get up too early in the morning. So we're going to see if we can't take these Jayhawks and make them
beautiful
farmers, since they admire the farmers so much.
Nice sickle.
Didn't prove nothing to me.
Well, maybe not, but Shoe Baby's going to prove a lot to some people. Watch out here. Just about anything, including a tennis racket. As we take a look once again, Jack Jackson stuck up on that shoulder of Bobby Jaggers, and then Dirty Dutch Mantell with that clothesline off of the top turnbuckle. The winners, Dutch Mantell, Bobby Jaggers, the Kansas Jayhawks.
More action after these commercial messages about the worldwide wrestling events coming to your area.
Two of the great ones, Todd Champion and Sam Houston. Welcome, guys.
How you doing? You know, Kansas Jayhawks, they're pretty good. And something I want to say to you, David, real quick, is you must have nerves of steel to have to sit out here week after week and listen to Jim Cornette's mouth and just know that you can't, you know, you can't reach over and slap him on national TV and everything. You do have nerves of steel. First of all, congratulations are also in store for Ronnie Garvin for winning. At the top of the program, you saw a film clip where he won the Mid-Atlantic Heavyweight Championship. Ronnie Garvin, my best wishes to you because he's a good friend of mine. He's got a title that I've been after for a long time, and I hope you hold it a long time, Ronnie. Another thing about it is the Russians are up to their tricks again. They come out there, they jump the man 3-on-1. Well, I've got every faith in the world in Ronnie Garvin and Magnum T.A. because I know for sure, real quick, they ain't going to let Nikita Koloff run around here for a long time with that U.S. title around his waist. That's like sacrilegious, you know. Now, there's some other things going on, too. In the Central States region, I've made a few trips out there, and I've really had a good time. And I'm going back out there some more, have even a better time. This time, I'm going to take Todd out with me. Me and Todd are going to have a good time out there. There's a lot of girls, there's a lot of women, and there's a lot of ladies. There's a lot of yeses, there's a lot of noes, and there's a lot of maybes. Try to get the ladies with the yeses.
That's right. You know, I got a good friend out there named Dave. Dave, we partied in L.A., we partied in Las Vegas, we've been coast to coast.
Mid-Atlantic champion Ronnie Garvin. We've got a new United States champion, Nikita Koloff. And you know, I feel better when I'm a champion. And that's what makes a great champion, is a great competition that they face. And like I say, I feel better and I look better when I got a championship belt around my waist. And I'll tell you right now, that's what I'm looking forward to. I'm talking to all you champions out there. Don Carnola's back and he's better than ever. And I'm looking forward to you. And we're speaking about new champions. We have a new junior heavyweight champion right here, world junior heavyweight champion, Denny Brown. It's my pleasure, Jimmy. Pleasure.
Thank you. Thank you very much. You know, David Crockett, they always say it comes in threes. Well, once again, for the third time, I am now the world's junior heavyweight champion. And I tell you, you know, I'm looking forward to traveling across the country, and especially I want to get down into the Central States area, and I want these people to gear up and get ready to go downtown with Denny Brown, the NWA's world junior heavyweight champion. No brag, that's fact.
All right, Denny, congratulations again. All right, ladies and gentlemen, let's go to the ring for more action. There you see him, the national heavyweight champion, Chief Wahoo McDaniel.
David, I think we should say right here that the night that Wahoo won the title of the Forum in L.A. was a great night for the NWA out on the West Coast. Great. Great night at the Forum. Over 10,000, 11,000 fans packed into the Forum to see the NWA. Was a night we'll never forget.
Look at Wahoo. Double arm suplex. Pressure going to death. Down for the band. He is still riding high from the win there in Los Angeles at the Forum.
You're right about that.
When he won the National Heavyweight title.
Holding on to that National Heavyweight Championship. Shoots the golden chair to the ropes, and then the big chop, and that just set him up for the double arm suplex right over the top. The National Heavyweight Champion, Chief Wahoo McDaniel, your winner, and Jim Cornette, stand by.
I'm here at ringside with Nature Boy Buddy Landell and his player coach, Bill Superstar Dundee, Australia's greatest athlete. Bill?
You know, Jimbo, everybody's like a broken record. Ric Flair comes out here, he'll name everybody in the wrestling business, but he won't wrestle nobody except Big Dusty Rhodes. And the reason he wrestles him, because he's walking around on a broke leg. It took four other guys to do it. Hey, Flair, I'm sick of looking at you wrestling Rhodes. Landell's sick of you looking at wrestling Rhodes. And so is all them people out there, because they want you to wrestle a real man. That's this guy right here. And Magnum T.A., you talk a great fight, Daddy. You talk a great fight. You want to climb in the ring with me, Jack? I know I forgot more about wrestling than you will ever know. So Flair, Rhodes, Magnum T.A., handsome Jimmy Valiant, you bald-headed geek. You want to wrestle somebody? I'll wrestle you. But no, we can't wait till tomorrow, can we?
Hell no, because we get better looking every day. Jimmy, you know I had a hard night last night, baby. Tell him why.
That's right, because you had a good-looking attack. Now, girls, if you like him short and dark, you got me. Tall and blonde, you got him. Come and get it, anybody who wants it.
And let's go to the ring for the next match. David, I want you to listen to that stuff. Bald-headed geek, I'm so sick of hearing that. These guys, these people in the audience making fun of Shaska's misfortune that he suffered at the hands of Jimmy Valiant. You can see that on the other side of the coin, Jimmy Valiant's a bald-headed geek now. It was Paul Jones and the Army that were responsible. And Shaska Whatley is right now going to prove to George South that the Army is willing to do anything that Paul Jones says, and that the Army is willing to protect Paul Jones at all costs, so that Jimmy Valiant will never shave his head, and so that Jimmy Valiant will have to retire from professional wrestling at the end of this year.
Mr. Cornette, it's not over yet. It's not the end of the year yet. Jimmy Valiant, he's going to get it.
I've been waiting for Jimmy Valiant's retirement for a long time now, and I am so happy that it's almost here. And look at Shaska Whatley, high elevation on a big backdrop on George South. And he is styling, profiling, moving, and grooving in the ring right now.
That he is. Shaska Whatley. What's he gonna do? Spins him around. Shaska, headbutt. Puts him down. Paul Jones outside the ring. ST Joe Con and the Barbarian to protect him, because he's always afraid of Jimmy Vann coming around.
And don't forget Baron Von Raschke, not here today, but our thoughts are with him. He's another member of the Army.
I know you turned away just for a second, but Paul Jones caught George South.
I didn't turn away, David. I had my eyes on Paul Jones the whole time. He never did a thing. I'll tell you one thing, though. I have never seen a bunch of guys as fired up in my life as Paul Jones' Army. He's got them set. He's got them ready. And he's got a lot of strategies in mind for them. A lot of strategies mapped out.
Catches George now.
Just to make sure that Jimmy Valiant doesn't get any closer to Paul Jones' hair than he has been in the past. And that's not too close. You see Paul Jones with a beautiful head of hair, styled, combed, washed. Jimmy Valiant never did any of that when he had hair. He never washed it. He never fixed it. He probably never seen what a comb looks like. He didn't deserve to have hair.
Shaska catches him with a hard right hand. He starts to strut.
George South has been fighting back. George South, a good young athlete, but Shaska just got the strength on him, got the size on him, and he picks him up, drives him into the turnbuckles. Took the wind right out of George South, and now he's setting him up, yeah, for that superplex. Shaska's superplex, one of the most dangerous maneuvers in wrestling. If he can keep George South stunned up on those top ropes,
He is going to have that superplex. He hooks him up. Seth about to go over, and there he has it. Beautiful. Shaska Whatley, one of the premier members of the Army, of Paul Jones.
Just like a missile.
And Jimmy Valiant, that's what's coming after you, baby. The Army and Paul Jones. If you think you can shave that man's head, you better get some serious help.
Once again, fans, it's your replay. We'll take a look at the superplex from Shaska. You can tell the Army is fired up and ready to do anything for their leader, their general, Paul Jones, including getting rid of Jimmy Valiant. When we come back, America's team and a special interview right after this segment.
Team Dusty Rhodes and Magnum T.A. Welcome, guys.
Well, thank you very much. You know, people come up to me all the time now. They say, what are you in the American Dream doing now that you've had all these mishaps, you've lost your titles, you're having to face all this adversity? But what we're doing is making plans, planning for the future. You know, that United States Tag Team Championship Tournament coming up. Well, America's team's going to put their bid in that tournament. It's going to be a very serious bid to be reckoned with, because we are champions. We are people who go out and say, and we're going to do something, and then we accomplish it. And Nikita Koloff, feel real comfortable wearing that title. But I'm hot on your trail. Ronnie Garvin's hot on your trail. And that title is not even close to being as safe as you think it is. And gorgeous Jimmy Garvin, I'm not hard to find. Don't be calling me out here on interviews, because this is no place to take care of business. The wrestling ring is where we take care of that kind of business. Just see if you can remember that.
When we're ready to do it, we're going to do it. But when Buddy Landell comes out here, Buddy Landell, you lost more sleep over me than I have over you, Daddy. And you come out here with superstar Billy Dundee. He reminds me of the bad gremlin in the Gremlin movie, the one they put in a microwave oven and it disappeared in about 3 seconds. He be messing with America's team, talking me down, talking Magnum down, the little gremlin. We're going to put him in a microwave oven and his old head going to blow off, Jack. So we ready. When we're ready for it, we're going to take it to it. And I know we got a pretty lady standing over here.
That's right. We have America's team. Now we have America's number one lady, United States champion, women's champion, Misty Blue.
Hi, how are you?
Fine, how are you? Welcome.
Thank you very much. I'm here, and I got the best competition coming in to go against me, and I'm going to be staying on number one, and I'm going to go all out and stay right there.
All right. Thank you very much. We'll have more action right after this. I'm going to Keto Koloff and Cruncher Cruz now.
And David, it looks like the 4th of July out here.
They're going to take on the Italian thing, Hex Guerrero and Rocky Kernodle.
All these people with American flags, everybody chanting USA, USA, all the people in the audience, just because that the Russian contingent in professional wrestling, Ivan and Nikita and Crusher, are here in the ring. They're trying to intimidate the poor Russians is what they're doing.
Watch Ivan, the general. He's the man that 90% of the time will start the match to feel out their opponent. Rocky catches midsection. He's got it.
Rocky Kernodle with a sunset flip. You know, the Italian Stallion, Rocky Kernodle, and of course Hector Guerrero, all three of them fine young athletes, so this should be an interesting match and a good test for the Russians. But like you said, Ivan Koloff, the ring general, he's the guy who trains Nikita and Crusher. He's the guy who maps out their ring strategy. He's the brains behind the brawn, and they...
He can get the job done.
All right, now we've got Crusher Khrushchev in the ring, one of the young powerhouses that Ivan is in control of.
All right, Crusher's there.
Koloff, I think David formed a dynasty for the future as far as Russian athletics go. Ivan has been a superstar for quite some time. And Hector Guerrero, again, confounding Crusher Khrushchev, drop kicking it all down. Here comes the Italian Stallion.
That's right. Austin picking up hard down on the arm. Comes out with that arm bar. Stitches up tight. He holds on. Well, Crusher tried to slam him.
The Italian Stallion, he's made a lot of strides as far as professional wrestling goes the last few months.
All right.
His reputation is spreading wider.
The Stallion backed out.
Let's see what else on the Stallion is going to get spread out because Nikita Koloff is in the ring. Right now, the United States Heavyweight Champion.
That is right. The Russian Nightmare. Nikita. United States Heavyweight Champion. We talk about the tournament. The United States Tag Team Tournament be held in Atlanta.
Oh, yeah. The Omni in Atlanta has been the scene traditionally of a lot of great tag team tournaments. This is going to be the greatest ever held there to determine the United States Tag Team Champions.
Ooh, look at that.
And my team and all the other teams are entered. Nikita taking over on the Italian Stallion, runs his head into the turnbuckles, makes the tag now, and here comes Ivan.
And Ivan takes him out, puts him across into the ropes. Puts the elbow right into the head. Goes into the ropes again. Cross the leg across the chest. Puts him down.
Stallion was hurt, but he still had enough power to push Ivan off before the three count. Bear hugs him.
Here
makes the tag out
Victor.
After Guerrero.
Woo! Here he goes. Good job. Gets way up again. Has him. Takes
Look
him out.
At that man
Puts
go.
Him across. Goes up. Pins Ivan down. Makes the tag. The Stallion comes in. Hard right hand to the head. Double whip.
For a short count of one, and now Stallion, he's got Koloff, but Ivan bear hugs him, brings him back into no man's land, and the Russian's corner attacks Crusher Khrushchev, hammer it on the midsection.
Double teaming, throws him back into the turnbuckle, take him out, they do it again.
Crusher throwing those rights, and he is beating Stallion's brains out over in that corner, and the referee, Tommy Young, trying to get in the middle there. Finally did get Stallion out of that corner and free from the Russians, but Crusher continues to hammer away on him.
Yeah, he does. Crusher picks him up. Position. Good.
Look at that power. Crusher may be the strongest of all the Russians. I know he's got a few pounds on Nikita in body weight. Ivan the ring general. Nikita, for pure meanness, you can't beat him, so.
Go behind, picks him over.
All the Russians have their specialties, David.
Now he starts to choke. Choking. Yes. For Nikita. Nikita has the tag. Here he comes. Double whip. Elbow again in the chest.
And they gave Stallion back that double elbow that his team had given them a few minutes earlier. And Stallion has not seen the light of day for about 2 or 3 minutes now in this match. Crusher with a short vertical suplex. Takes him over, hits the ropes. Just doesn't have the size. He's outweighed by 100 pounds by Big Crusher Khrushchev. He didn't have the size, but he's going to the air.
Has his side body blocked for the almost put him out.
The cross body took him down, but it couldn't take him out. And now Crusher, the sickle.
The sickle caught him.
On top of Rocky Granola holding him down, and that's the three count.
What an exciting match this was, but in the end, it was the size of the Russians, and especially right there, Crusher Khrushchev, with the Russian sickle that prevailed over Rocky Granola, the Italian Stallion, and Hector Guerrero. Right there, the Russian sickle. The Russian team, the winners of the match, and we'll be back with the new Mid-Atlantic Heavyweight Champion. Don't go away.
Me. Mayday, mayday, I'm being attacked by zits.
Pilot to gunner, break out the Oxy-10.
Roger, Oxy's cocked and ready. Look out, zit at 5 o'clock, fire one. All right, Oxy clobbered it. Watch out, another zit, dead ahead.
The benzoyl peroxide in Oxy zeroes in on zits and destroys them.
That's all of them. Let's head for home.
Oxy 10, we're winning the war against zits.
Life is filled with unexpected twists and turns. When you feel lost, frightened, alone, turn to your house of worship and find your way with God.
Hey, ladies and gentlemen, with great pleasure, I present to you the new Mid-Atlantic Heavyweight Champion, Ron Garvin. And again, congratulations. Last week, you knocked Nikita Koloff out.
Well, thank you, David. You know, I needed this title. You know, I've been in a slump lately. But, you know, you got to keep plugging on. You got to keep plugging. You got to keep going. And it came through to me. This national heavyweight, I mean, this Mid-Atlantic Heavyweight title, it's not just a chum belt, you know. To represent the Mid-Atlantic area, and there's a lot of fans in the Mid-Atlantic area. It covers a lot of grounds, and I'm going to try to defend it the best of my ability. And this title here is going to be a stepping stone to the United States heavyweight title. And Nikita Koloff, I've done it all by myself. I knocked you out. And it proves one thing to me. When you come three against me, it proves one thing to me, Nikita, is you're scared. You're scared to lose what you got, you see. And I'm the man that's qualified to do the job. You got my attention. You tried to cripple me. You didn't try to knock me out. You tried to take my head off, put me out of wrestling, and I'm going to tell you something. I'm coming after the man, and I'm going to take it.
Let's show the people exactly what you're talking about in that tape. Let's show the fans. There you see it, right there. This is you winning that title.
We're talking about after 20 minutes of wrestling, hard-fought match. You know, Blackbird's a big man. It was not no easy match. It was a hard-fought match. I took him. I got the 1-2-3 on him. And believe me, after you step in that ring and wrestle a man for 20 minutes, you're a little tired. You're wore out. I never expected three men to come and attack me. And right here, referee declares me the winner. I'm a very happy man because, you know, a title means money. Title means prestige. Stepping stone to the United States title. Stepping stone to the world title. Any title. And now I'm fighting three men right here. As you can see, I'm already wore down. Got three Russian. You talk about superior athletes. It takes three of them to beat up on one guy. I don't mind a beating, but just the thought behind. Try to cripple me, take my head off, put me out of wrestling. Look at this maneuver. It can put you out of wrestling. I've seen it happen, and I know what's behind this. Try to put me up. Well, you didn't do the job. I'm still standing, and I'm coming at you, Nikita Koloff, and I'm coming to get that title. You have declared war. You got my attention, and I'm going to show you exactly that I ain't playing no games. You're talking about the real thing, Jack. You're not talking about cartoon wrestling on TV. You're talking about wrestling. Ronnie Garvin, the national, I mean the United States title. I'm so upset, man. I'm about to go crazy, but I'm going to get the man. I don't care where it's at.
All right, the Mid-Atlantic Heavyweight Champion, Ron Garvin, let's go to the ring.
And show everybody that bald head of his. That's what I want to know. And why doesn't the Raging Bull take those silly looking pants off? Mulkey Mania in action, and you see Randy Mulkey with the rib brace on that my man Bubba caused him to have to wear a couple of weeks ago, as you will remember. And he's still moving around the ring pretty sorely. And the Raging Bull making him even sore as he catches him with a flying burrito.
What teamwork.
Yeah, some winners.
Bet they are.
You know, we said the Paul Jones Army was ready to stand up for their leader, go go through a brick wall if necessary to prevent Jimmy Valiant from cutting his hair. On the other side of the coin, you take a look at the man like the Raging Bull in Jimmy Valiant's corner, and you think, yes, it's going to happen to Paul Jones. The Raging Bull and Jimmy Valiant are your winners, and back with more right after this.
Stay tuned for more action after these commercial messages about the worldwide wrestling events coming to your area.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we started to talk to these two young gentlemen a little while ago. Sam Houston, he talked, but we really didn't get a chance to talk to you, Todd. What about your career? We're talking about the Central States. What about those titles out there?
Well, I tell you what, it's a great opportunity to go to Kansas City, and there's a tag team Central States title that I'm looking forward to get a hold of. I've got a good friend named Dave Peterson. He's up there. We finally teamed together. We've been friends for a long time. And it's finally a goal of mine to be a champion, because my last name is Champion. And so I have a lot of things to live up to. But there's something else we got to talk about, and that's the pretty ladies in Kansas City. You see, Sam's not married, and I'm not married. And we're young and single, and we like to mingle. So when we come up to Kansas City, not only do we want the belts, but we want everything that goes with it. The pretty ladies, the nice restaurants, the nice clubs. That's what we're all about. Well, Sam's got something in his hand. I don't know what it is. It looks like a lucky rock or something.
Yeah, that's my lucky rock, Todd. You know what it means when I rub my lucky rock?
What's that?
It means we're going to get lucky tonight. You know, I'll tell you something else. We're going to get a whole lot luckier in the Central States area, too. There's a lot of good competition, and we can take it. You know, I've been there a few times now, and there's a little bit of problem here and there. But I think with us, you know, you and I and Dave Peterson and Italian Stan and people like that, good, strong, young kids like us, we can take care of any problem that comes up in our faces.
And the Warlord.
That's right. The Warlord is probably one of the biggest wrestlers in professional wrestling today. And I'm going to take him all over the world because, you see, I have been around the world. And he's just the wrestler to do it for me because, you see, Ric Flair is a very, very busy man. And he doesn't always have time for baby doll. And his pedestal always doesn't have time for baby doll. But I have time for Warlord. And wherever the competition is, that's where Warlord is being. You can bet where Warlord is, baby doll's going to be there. No matter where in the country it is, no matter where in the world it is, baby doll's going to be there.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, let's go to the ring.
And you know something, David? They're a great-looking couple, but another great-looking couple. You know, Nature Boy Ric Flair's been taking Baby Doll around to a lot of social events here recently, and I was at one of them. I took my mother, and my mother and Baby Doll, they got over in the corner. They started talking, and my mother fell in love with Baby Doll. I couldn't believe it. I didn't know what to do. The end result is going to be that Baby Doll's going to be decorating my house. Mother made all the arrangements. She got her appointment book out, scheduled it with Baby Doll. The woman has talents that I didn't realize. You know, we're still not on the best of terms, but hey, she's got Ric Flair. She's got a fine athlete there. She's with the Four Horsemen. And in addition to that, my mother approves of her. She can't be all bad. And right now, hey, here's a guy who can't be all bad. Gorgeous Jimmy Garvin, and Rocky King is feeling the pressure now because Gorgeous Jimmy's taking that attack to him. Gorgeous Jimmy doesn't want to let Precious down. Precious is his woman out there. And she takes real good care of him, and he likes to impress her.
That he does. Gorgeous Jimmy Garvin now takes Rocky King. Backs him into the ropes. Throws him across. King. Backdrop. Gorgeous Jimmy takes his time. Gets him ready. Position.
Gorgeous is setting him up, and he gives it to him. Gorgeous Jimmy Garvin, the one and only, and the brainbuster, and a victory. Once again, who's going to deal with Jimmy Garvin? That's the question he's asking, and he's asking it mainly of a guy named Magnum T.A. And now Gorgeous Jimmy just ships Rocky King right out of the ring.
Okay. I guess everybody knows. Did you hear me, boy? You said that I do my talking and my wrestling on interviews. Well, where's he at? Obviously, he's afraid of me. Obviously.
Here he comes.
Yeah. It's about time. It's about time.
Magnum just sort of tossed her off right there. But then, Jimmy Garvin put the knee into his back, put him down on the ground, and rammed his head into the post. But Magnum T.A. is not finished with Gorgeous Jimmy Garvin yet. He's going to come back. I guarantee you Magnum will issue the challenge this time. He'll go after Gorgeous Jimmy Garvin. If Precious is in the way, he'll get rid of her too. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we'll see you next week on the very best of professional wrestling, Worldwide Wrestling.
Worldwide Wrestling is a presentation of the JCP Sports Network and has been furnished to the station for broadcast at this time by Jim Crockett Promotions in exchange for commercial consideration.